This is a public on the record discussion. In fact, we'll be preserving it for posterity on film, and also, of course, ask that, and I will demonstrate turning off your cell phones, which I have not done until now. Just want to say that. So when I came to here to NTI in 2017, one of the initiatives, probably not surprising as a physicist, was to really put some additional focus on science and technology issues, and having NTI internally and with partners bring technology more to bear on some of the issues that we. That we face, some of the threats that we are trying to mitigate here. And that starts with good information. In particular here, now, of course, when President Putin first announced the six major new systems that were under development, we thought it very important to really have a good, sound understanding. Then also as a basis for policy to understand what those systems really are, what's their status, when might we see a deployment, which could be anything from a short time to infinity, but Jill will discuss that. That motivation pretty much coincided with Jill Ruby's joining us as the first Sam Nunn Distinguished Fellow, a position that we created to bring outstanding people here for terms with Jill. She's approaching a year to really help us focus on some new problems. So Jill is triple-hatted, Sam Nunn Distinguished Fellow, which she has admitted to today on her slide. In addition, we've also formed, consistent with this increased focus on technology, a new science and technology committee. I don't know if Paige is here today. I'm not sure. No, he's not here. Our VP for technology. Anyway, so that committee has been formed with John Holdren as the chair. Jill is a member of that committee. Just recently was elected to our board of directors. So that's the triple hatting that we see there. So Jill, I think many of you know, or most of you know, or possibly all of you know, had a, I forget, 34, was it 34 year, year career at Sandia National Laboratory, culminating in her being named the director of the laboratory. So I think your credentials for this study are not to be doubted. Although we do want to emphasize that while she may know more, this is a completely open source document. So something that we can all discuss. And indeed, then Lynn Rustin will follow with a initial kind of analysis of the implications of these systems for issues like strategic stability in our relationship with Russia. And then following Lynn's remarks, Senator Nunn will also talk about these broad implications for the whole U.S.-Russia relationship. So that's what we're planning to do today, and of course we'll have it opened up then to the audience, all of you, for questions. So with that, I think I'm just going to say, Jill, let's go.
Thanks, sir. Well, thank you all for coming today. I hope you learned something, but this was a really fun study to do. Because what I tried to do in this study was scour the open source literature, mostly originating in Russia. A lot of it's in blogs. A lot of it's in news reporting from various sources. And what I really tried to do is put these systems, the descriptions of these systems together in one place, but more importantly, check test results and activities against pronouncements. And to try to line up what we think, what seems to be real And so I think that's really the value of the work, and I hope you'll agree. So let me go through these systems. Turn this thing on. There we go. So as Ernie mentioned, there was a bit of a surprising event in March of 2018 when President Putin decided to make public the new nuclear weapon delivery systems that Russia was developing. He did this in his annual address to his federal assembly and apparently even changed the venue for this address so that videos could be shown and there were better graphic capabilities. He spent 40% of his annual address, so imagine this in the U.S., talking about nuclear weapons. So it was a clear message, not only to the United States and NATO, but to the Russian public that Russia remained relevant nuclear power and was advancing their capabilities. He declared that all the systems under development were for the sole purpose of evading U.S. missile defenses, and that they would not be deterred. That was, you know, that was a strong statement. We will not be deterred. I do want to say that as I start this, I'm not talking about nuclear warheads or nuclear weapon design. The delivery systems is what Putin has released publicly. The nuclear warheads and their design remain secret with very little information in the public and very little information in my report. So he announced six systems in March 2018. Five of those were nuclear weapon delivery systems. One was a laser-based space system. But in 2019, he announced another system, a conventional system, that many believe could be nuclear capable in the future. So this number six is a little bit confusing. He announced six systems in 2018, five of which were nuclear. He announced another system in 2019 that could become nuclear in the future. So six shows up a number of times, but for different reasons. So as a result of making these systems public, it's a real opportunity for us to study them and know much more about them. So here's what they are in brief, and then I'll talk about each one in one slide. So one is a replacement or upgrade to a strategic range intercontinental ballistic missile. The rest are all new systems that have not been deployed before. Three of those are hypersonic systems. One is the one hypersonic system is the one that's conventional system. There's been no pictures released, so it's not shown here. But this is a hypersonic system, and this is a hypersonic system. That's the ICBM, a new nuclear-powered, nuclear-tipped torpedo, and a new nuclear-powered, nuclear-tipped cruise missile. So let me first talk about the ICBM. The first thing I'm going to do here is show a video. So here's the video they released. There's the ICBM in an ejection test, goes through trees and comes out as a computer animation. because so far it's only been tested for the ejection has only been tested, perhaps the first phase. But that's the computer video that he showed at the news conference. Interesting about this ICBM, so it's a replacement for the SS-18. The SS-18 is the Satan ICBM, called Satan by NATO. This is supposed to have some new technical characteristics, a short boost phase to make it difficult or confused detection as it lifts off. That means a new engine, a new fuel, likely. It has a 16,000 kilometer range. 16,000 kilometers allows you to approach the U.S. from the South Pole, not just the North Pole, so longer range, and a composite body so that it can carry a lot of warheads and the missile isn't so heavy, right? That's called throw weight, big high throw weight. And most sources report 10 to 16 independently targeted warheads, including the Avangard, which is one of the hypersonic systems. I'll come back to that, and advanced decoys. Now, the number of warheads is not, it's not clear. There is reported as little as three, as many as 24. The current SS18 has 10, so it likely has 10 or maybe a few more. So 10 to 16 tends to be the range that's mostly reported, but a lot of uncertainty in how many warheads it has. In terms of the deployment schedule, they had hoped to have this ready to deploy in 2016 to 2018. Lots of news reporting saying that they intend to deploy it then. But as I said, only the ejection mechanism and maybe the first phase has been tested, so the whole system has not been tested yet. In addition, a fire occurred at the production facility for the Sarmat in April of 2019, delaying the schedule. The expectation now is deployment and maybe as early as 2022, and then continuously until things are replaced to 2027. These dates come from when the current missile sort of times out. So they've done one life extension on that missile. They either need to do another life extension or deploy this, or so it seems. The military objective is exactly the same military objective as other ICBMs, except this one is intended to be more difficult to detect and perhaps evade missile defenses. Now I'm going to talk about the three hypersonic systems. Before I do, I just want to say a brief few words about hypersonics. So hypersonics are fast. Obviously, that's the word. Mach 5 or higher is the technical definition of a hypersonic. But it's important to remember they're not faster than ICBMs or most ballistic missiles. So speed is actually not, isn't the thing that's special about hypersonics, at least when compared to ballistic missiles. What is special about hypersonics is they're harder to detect because they fly at lower altitudes, so they don't fly a ballistic trajectory that's predictable and easy to detect with our current systems. So they're harder to detect. They fly lower, so line of sight radar from the Earth makes them harder to doesn't make them harder to see. It takes longer to see them. But if they are maneuverable, it's harder to predict the target and harder to follow through the detection. So they are important military and new military instruments. There are two types of hypersonics. And since I say this, I'm going to tell you Russia's doing a third type. But the two types that we typically call hypersonics are glide vehicles. Glide vehicles are boosted to high speed and altitude on a ballistic missile. And then they glide along the upper atmosphere unpowered and then descend to target. The other type of hypersonic missile is a cruise missile. Cruise missiles are powered by a kind of engine called a scramjet that can work at speeds like this. They have to get to a certain speed for the scramjet to work, so they're usually powered by a rocket motor first, and then the scramjet kicks in. And they go usually a little bit slower than glide vehicles. Hypersonic vehicles are very challenging. They reach high temperature because they fly through the atmosphere and surrounded by a plasma, so they have to survive high temperatures of about 2,000 degrees C. And it's also very difficult to communicate through plasma, so you have to solve those problems for hypersonics. These pictures are actually the U.S. and Russia systems, the U.S. and China system. So I just wanted to say that Russia is not alone in developing hypersonics, as you all know. China has developed a hypersonic system called the DF-17, shown here in their parade in October. And the U.S. has developed hypersonic system, a common glide vehicle shown below the Chinese system. Okay, so let me talk about the first hypersonic system. So this is a very innovative system. It's a hypersonic system that is neither a glide vehicle nor a cruise missile, but this is a very fast system that is flown to altitude and pretty high speed by an interceptor jet, a MiG-31K. This interceptor jet drops this missile. It's a modified ground missile, an Iskander missile. The solid rocket engine is then lit, and it follows basically a ballistic track. to target. It has fins, so it has some maneuverability in its final phases, but it is hypersonic because it does go above Mach 5. It is claimed to be both conventional and nuclear capable, furthest along of these systems in development. Is believed to be in trial deployment after hundreds of tests, likely as a conventional system. The thing about the nuclear system, so the ground missile has a nuclear option with a reported 10 to 50 kiloton warhead. So if this has a nuclear option, it's probably somewhat similar to that. The beauty of the nuclear option is the system doesn't have to be as precise. Because you get a bigger boom out of the nuclear option. We believe the military objective are missile defense installations. That's consistent with we don't like your missile defenses, and other high-value assets such as carrier groups. So let me talk about the Avangard. So I mentioned when I talked about the SARMAT, the new ICBM, that it might carry, it is meant to carry a hypersonic missile, the Avangard. Let me show this video. So the picture here is animation of the ICBM stages separating. And then the Avangard being flown as a hypersonic system. So you can see lots of computer animation. Doesn't mean the systems aren't being designed and tested. In fact, the systems are being designed and tested, but there are not photographs or images of the actual systems. So this, so the Avangard is a traditional boost glide system, rides on an ICBM. It's been under development in the Soviet Union, then Russia for a long time, since the 80s. Since 2014, they had an intensive test campaign on this system. They've had three successful tests and one failure in that period of time. And they're using old SS-19 ICBMs in SS-18 silos for testing purposes. There's some limited number of SS-19 still around. They had a test that flew 6,000 kilometers, so it was a strategic range test. In December of 2018, that obtained speeds of about Mach 20. The technical characteristics, as reported, are this thing is pretty long. It's 18 feet long. That's a pretty long hypersonic vehicle. We don't know what the geometry is, but it is reported to have a composite body. It's dual capable with warhead yields reported from 150 kiloton to 2 megaton. I tend to think it'd be closer to the 150 kiloton because of weight. The deployment schedule is to deploy a couple of these on SS-19s in 2020 or, but I don't think that will happen. It seems like it'll be 2022 or later. And I don't think that will happen without additional testing. So I think one of the telltale signs of whether or not a hypersonic system is deployed with a nuclear warhead will be more testing. On the SS-18, one Avangard would be carried. The military objective is, ICBM warhead with the same military objectives as other ICBM warheads, but also potentially missile defense installations or high-value targets, such as command centers or missile silos. The next and final hypersonic system is the Sircon. This is the system that was announced in 2019, not in 2018, that it was announced as a conventional system, not a nuclear system. It's a hypersonic cruise missile. So we now have the full range of hypersonics, and we have the full range of delivery capabilities. This is actually intended to be sea launch, likely from a surface ship. This has a solid fuel first phase, a scramjet second phase. It's been under development and active testing. It's believed in the literature, a new metal alloy to withstand the high temperatures. It's expected they have a short range. Scramjet engines don't yet last very long, so they haven't been developed so that they can fly for a long time, so they typically fly a few minutes. So the expected range of this is a short range, a 500 kilometer-like missile. It will be deployed on battle cruisers with the universal launcher, mid to late 2020s, optimistically, I think, in this system. And the real objective is to destroy carrier groups. So let me just pause again and say, a new type of hypersonic aeroballistic missile, a boost glide vehicle on an ICBM, and this missile, short-range missile on sea. So this is land, sea, and air, a triad of three different types of hypersonic missiles. So a lot of development activity. The Poseidon is the nuclear, this is one of the advanced systems, there are two. This is the nuclear-powered torpedo, nuclear-tipped torpedo. This system was called Status 6 by the Russians and Canyon by NATO. By the way, this system and the next system were named by the public in a online naming contest or vote. So it has been termed the Poseidon, which of course in the U.S. is sort of a unusual name since we have a Poseidon also. But it's carried and released from submarines. Here's a video of how this thing would be released by the submarine. It comes out and then it starts. Of course, you can see this is computer animation. It's expected to have a 10,000 kilometer range. It runs fast and deep for a torpedo. It'd be difficult to detect. Difficult to detect. The scary thing about this is that it is said, originally it was said to carry a 50 to 100 megaton warhead. It's now reported to be a 2 megaton warhead, but that's a big warhead, potentially surrounded by cobalt, which could be thrown over a wide area if detonated and cause additional contamination. In this case, the propulsion system for the Poseidon is in sea testing. Submarines are being modified to carry it. They can be seen on open source satellite images. Russia has planned, has in their planning calls for 32 to be deployed between 2018 and 2027. I judge this very unlikely to be deployed before 2027. Due to the technical challenges associated with nuclear-powered unmanned torpedo. The military objective for this is a little bit hard to explain. It does seem that it's a retaliatory second strike to destroy or contaminate U.S. coastal cities or submarine bases without interception. Carrier groups were added as a target in the Russian literature lately. And, it's believed by many that it would hold cities at risk while Avangard holds missile bases at risk. And then finally, the last system is the nuclear-powered, nuclear-tipped cruise missile called the Burevestnik. It is called Skyfall by NATO. This is a system that is a subsonic cruise missile. Again, nuclear power plants heat air. The air powers the missile. It can fly 23,000 kilometers purportedly, or is meant to, could stay aloft for a couple of days. What makes this system interesting is that it's hard to defeat. It's got a nuclear power plant and a nuclear warhead on it. So it's slow moving. It's flying around the globe. You probably will see it. But then what are you going to do? And so it's an interesting weapon. There was a similar effort a long time ago in the U.S., and that effort called Project Pluto is often used to discredit this effort, say it will never happen. But a lot has changed in terms of nuclear power, closed-loop cycle nuclear power plants and cruise missiles. So while I don't think this is going to be deployed anytime soon, and I think there's lots of technical development, I wouldn't dismiss it. And in fact, they have been testing it, and when they test it, flies for a short while, and then it intentionally lands in the sea or fails by landing into the sea. The military objective for this, again, unknown, but according to a military expert who writes for the Russian military defense, he called it a weapon of retaliation after ICBMs finished the route of all military and civilian infrastructure. So just now in closing, so I would say, there's significant technical effort by the Russians on these systems, and their efforts are real. Design is real, test is real. It's slow, and it's expensive, and it's not complete on any of the systems. So the Russians are gonna have to decide how much money they're willing to spend, what they're really going to deploy, and when they're going to deploy it. But in general, all the systems are beyond their announced test and deployment dates. There's no indication that any of these systems will meet the deployment dates announced, except the Kinzhal, which is in trial deployment. And there have been significant difficulties in addition to the fire at the ICBM plant. There has been reported difficulties in obtaining composite materials for the Avangard, perhaps for the Sarmat as well. And then there was an accident that killed seven people, we believe, including people from their nuclear weapons complex in August of 2019 that has been linked to a test of one of the advanced systems. This indicates that the system is being pushed pretty hard. And perhaps because of the public announcement, the need to make progress is felt strongly within the Russian military system. I would say, so the dates will be a little bit longer. We'll see what they continue developing and what they continue testing. And then finally, Russia has been a very responsible nuclear state. We have not seen deployments of systems without testing there. And so most of these systems haven't been tested enough that, at least I believe, that they're ready for nuclear deployment. So with that, I'm going to stop and invite Lynn and Senator Nunn up. Lynn's going to talk about some work that she and Mark Melamed did on the strategic implications of these systems. And then Senator Nunn's going to close it out before Q&A.
Well, first of all, thanks very much, Jill. I have to say, for all of us at NTI, it's really been a pleasure to interact with Jill over the last year, and this hasn't been her only project, but it's certainly been an interesting project. And even for those of us who follow these matters pretty closely, I certainly have learned a lot and finally kind of gotten straight in my head the different systems and learned a lot in terms of where they are in development. And we've also had good discussions about what does it all mean. So let me first start by saying that we all understand these Russian systems are not being developed in a vacuum. They're being developed in an environment where the United States, China, other countries are also developing weapon systems, nuclear deliverable weapon systems, and new technologies. And so in any discussion of the policy implications, it's really important to have that context as a central element of the discussion. That said, there's been a lot of attention paid to these Russian systems in particular since President Putin began speaking about them in 2018. And sometimes there's been more heat than light about them, and they've been discussed. And so that's why Jill's open source assessment of all of them with her technical background to really kind of, you know, test them against what she understands about engineering and whatnot has been really helpful. So I'm sure it'll be a useful resource for the community as we start to talk about it. And so with that as a foundation, my colleague Mark Melamed and with help from others at NTI have done some analysis, a companion paper, just to begin to answer the question of, you know, so what? You know, what is, you know, what does it mean? What are the implications? And the most immediate policy implication is, you know, or question is, what are the implications of what we understand about these systems for the current debate and consideration in our country about whether or not to extend the New START treaty? Probably just about everybody in this audience knows what that is, but briefly, it is the only remaining treaty that's regulating U.S. and Russian nuclear systems. It limits our strategic offensive arms, it provides intrusive verification, and it will expire in a little over a year, in February of 2021, unless the two countries agree to exercise the provision in the treaty that provides for another five-year extension. And where we are on that right now is that the Russians have expressed an interest in an extension and a desire to talk about it. And the administration so far has indicated it's still studying the matter and isn't prepared to have that discussion yet. One of the main concerns that's been articulated by people in the executive branch and testimony and in Congress who have not yet decided whether they support extension has been a concern that Russia is developing these weapon systems and that they would run free of the treaty constraints. But the analysis that Mark and I have done comes to a different conclusion. And the first conclusion is, of the systems that Jill talked about, the two that are most likely of the strategic systems, I should be clear, that Russia is most likely to be in a position to deploy from a technical standpoint, that's the Sarmat ICBM and the Avangard hypersonic vehicle deployed on an ICBM, those two systems clearly fall under the treaty. They will be covered if they come into deployment. The Sarmat ICBM, no debate whatsoever, meets the definition of an ICBM under the treaty. It will be covered, and the warheads deployed on it will be accountable. Similarly, the Avangard, if deployed on an ICBM, which is what the Russians plan right now, it will be accountable as a reentry vehicle, as a warhead under the treaty. So that's a really significant conclusion, again, because those are two systems that are actually likely to be deployed. And I should note that not only will these systems, you know, be under the treaty's limits and verification, but there's a requirement in the treaty for any systems, so in this case any new ones, to be exhibited. So there will be an on-site inspection where U.S. inspectors go and are, you know, visually close to these items. They're taking measurements. They're identifying the distinguishing features, which will then, during the remainder of the life of the treaty, allow them to, you know, identify what that thing is when they see it on future inspections. So without the treaty, we won't have the opportunity to do that. I'll say that Mark and I concluded this analysis quite a while ago before these reports were put to bed and sent to the printer, but significantly in just the last 2 weeks, senior Russian officials, the foreign minister, the deputy foreign minister, and the Russian representative to the joint the Bilateral Consultative Commission, which is the implementing body of the treaty, have actually publicly now stated that, in fact, these two systems will be covered under the treaty. That is a significant clarification by the Russians that should allay concerns about such systems running, you know, free of the treaty if we extend it. And obviously that's a commitment that I would urge the administration to get in writing in the context of extending the treaty. But it's a really important development. Regarding the two other strategic systems that Jill talked about, the Poseidon and the torpedo, and then this the nuclear-powered cruise missile, again, it's significant that Jill's assessment is they're not likely to come into force even, you know, during the lifetime of the extended New START treaty, which would end in February of 2026. But there's a provision in the treaty. They do not fall under the definitions of covered items, but they could be subject to discussion as a new kind of strategic offensive arm. And there's a right in the treaty that if a side feels that one is being developed, they can raise it in the commission. And so there's an opportunity to use the forum of the treaty to talk about these systems. Even better would be some understanding that if they were to come into deployment while the treaty was still in force, that there would be an agreement to talk about them and have them covered under the treaty. But basically, there's time to address that in the commission, given Jill's technical assessment. So let me just conclude that with a couple of comments. I mean, one, you know, extending the treaty allows us to maintain limits and verification on Russia's existing systems and on the new ones that are likely to be deployed. The alternative to that is no limits, no verification. There's really no prospect of negotiating a new treaty in the remaining and getting it ratified in the time remaining. So that, you know, creates some stability and buys the sides time to do what they should be doing, which is having strategic stability talks about how to address other kinds of weapons, different ranges, different types, novel technologies, and you know, how to address them in future arms control, and how to have kind of reduced the kind of competition that's taking place now, especially in nuclear arms, and get us on a more stable footing. So with that, I'll turn it over to Senator Nunn to give some additional observations on that point.
Thank you, Lynn. First, let me thank you, Jill, for an excellent paper. I think the fact this is open source is extremely valuable, because we've all heard all sorts of things about the new Russian systems, and of course, having it open source is enormously important for the debate, and particularly the debate that is inevitable that Lynn just referenced, which is whether these new developments mean that we should or should not be more inclined to extend START. And it makes Lynn's point, makes it pretty powerful and clear that the new systems would be covered, and even the Russians have said so. So that is very important, I think, development. Let me just make 3 points. But first, Ernie, thank you for appointing Jill to the inaugural Sam Nunn Distinguished Fellow. I'm extremely honored. All of us at NTI are delighted to have Jill, but I'm particularly honored. She brings tremendous expertise and a tremendous background to us, and she has already made enormous contributions. So thank you, Ernie, and thank you, Jill. 3 points. Number one, Ernie and I made this in our recent foreign affairs article on Russia and the United States relationship. But my point number one is we've moved into a much higher risk nuclear era than we were in a number of years ago. Reasons for this, of course, many, but the primary from my perspective, and Ernie's, I think, agree with this, are the technological advances that have taken place, cyber, artificial intelligence, possible weaponization of space, all of that's coming very rapidly. The second is what has already been alluded to, and that is the breakdown of arms control, starting with the ABM treaty, breakdown. Cancellation, the CFE treaty, Conventional Forces in Europe treaty, and the Intermediate Nuclear Forces, or INF treaty. And the other contributing factor is a pretty darn powerful one, is one that we've got to, I think we and Russia have to cure, and that is the absence of dialogue with Russia on strategic stability. Or I would say not just on strategic stability, but on the lack thereof as we have moved into this higher risk area. Point number two, Jill's paper and Lynn's and Mark's analysis raises several questions, and let me just point out three. One question is what does armed control look like? What does it look like when we have dynamic technological developments that are moving very, very rapidly? We've always had technological developments, but probably not at this pace ever before. And as these developments come along, the United States and Russia do not seem to be able to update treaties. All of the treaties that have been canceled, in all likelihood, without much doubt, needed updating. ABM treaty needed updating, the CFE treaty needed updating, and certainly the INF treaty needed updating. But instead of updating them, when the original risk they were designed to curb have not gone away, instead of updating them, we and the Russians seem to be inclined to throw them in the trash can, and that's what's happened. So that's a big question. How do we update treaties and agreements? The other point I would make is that new treaties take years to negotiate. In this complicated era we're in now, they take years to negotiate, and at best, it takes at least 2 or 3 years to ratify a treaty. So you're talking about a period of 3 to 5 to 6 to 7 years, and while those treaties are being negotiated and hopefully ratified, if they deserve ratification, technology is marching on, and that makes it extremely difficult. Another question that comes from these studies and Lynn's analysis and Mark's, what's the role of China and other nuclear weapon states? Most treaties are almost exclusively United States and Russia. At what stage does China get involved and how? That's enormously important because of China's nuclear capability, but also because they're developing artificial intelligence very rapidly, cyber capabilities they already have. And the final point, final question that comes to me out of what you've heard this morning, can we avoid an action-reaction arms race type spiral, offense, defense, so forth and so on, with the Russians? Or is the horse out of the barn? Is it too late? I think that question is front and center. I don't think it's too late because of the stakes involved, but nevertheless, that's going to be the debate. The third point I would make is Ernie and I, as I referred to it a moment ago, recently wrote an article in Foreign Affairs. And some of the points we made there, I think, are very relevant to the discussion this morning. The first point, and probably the most important point, is none of these challenges can really be successfully managed between the United States and Russia without a sustained and serious dialogue. And we simply do not have that. Certainly, we do not have it on the nuclear stability issue, or again, the lack of nuclear stability. The other couple of points that we made in that article that I think are worth repeating this morning, we have moved in this new nuclear era for several reasons, but among the most important is compressed decision time. We've always had short decision time, very short decision time, but the developments in the cyber world and the artificial intelligence world, possibility of false warnings and so forth, make the decision time by both President of Russia and the President of the United States very, very short. And the same can be said even more so with some other nuclear states, particularly India and Pakistan. What does this mean? In my view, it means that war by blunder, nuclear war by blunder, or nuclear use by blunder or accident is far more likely, in my view, than a premeditated bolt out of the blue attack. And war by blunder is not easily deterred, but it has to be avoided. And that's something that I think all countries, including non-nuclear states, and indeed the whole world, have a huge stake in. And my final point, even if we conclude that certain areas, maybe, for instance, cyber, don't lend themselves to treaties or formal written legal agreements, That does not mean we should not be diligently working with Russia in particular, but also with China at some point on what I would call rules of the road, transparency, mutual understandings, and particularly when it comes to cyber, red lines, so that we have restraint. So the fact we find it difficult to negotiate and ratify treaties or have legally binding agreements does not mean that we should not have a tremendous amount of emphasis on developing these kind of understandings, these kind of rules of the road, and these kind of red lines. So bottom line, thank you, Jill. Excellent paper. And Lynn, you and Mark, thank you very much for your commentary.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you very much, Senator. And now we're going to ask Secretary Moniz to come up and take this seat, and I will stand up and moderate a Q&A session. And look forward to your questions. We're going to actually kind of start over on this side of the room just because we only have one mic, and we'll work our way to questions on this side of the room. So any questions for any of us? Rita. Wait a minute. I think Secretary Moniz gets the first right of refusal, and he's not refusing.
All right. Jill, going back to this August accident.
Yes.
Going back to the August accident, is there anything more that you can say or speculate? Obviously, it seems there was a nuclear reactor involved. Therefore, it would be zeroed in on two of those systems. The torpedo lives in the water. I don't know, as a leading speculation.
Well, the press has attributed, the U.S. press has attributed this to an accident involving the Skyfall. I personally think it was an accident involving the Poseidon because it was a test in the sea where we believe the Poseidon is being tested, and it makes a lot of sense that a nuclear reactor for a torpedo might be tested, and a propulsion system might be tested at sea. But again, the press and apparently the U.S. intelligence community has attributed the accident to a recovery of the cruise missile from the ocean. So, but in any case, it's a nuclear reactor accident on an advanced system. On the new system. So, one of those two systems. The press and the intelligence community comes down one way, I come down another. They're probably right, but it's always good to speculate.
And Jill, to clarify, is basing that comment on what the United States has publicly said about its assessment.
Yes, yeah.
Rita.
Thank you very much, and I congratulate you on this excellent paper. It certainly does add a great deal to the community, so thank you. My question has to do with whether or not you could potentially speculate on when these systems were first, when the development of these systems and testing of these systems was first anticipated. Obviously, what we're seeing now is a result of years of work that perhaps was less transparent to us. So do you have any sense of when these weapons were first anticipated to be for development?
Yeah, well, leaving the ICBM aside, because, you know, they knew the lifetime of their ICBMs just like we do. And so I'm sure that has been planned for a long time. And I think, honestly, they may be still down selecting exactly what capabilities they're going to implement on the Sarmat. But the Avangard has been, or the Boost Glide hypersonic vehicle has been under development, we know, since Soviet times, and in fact tested, if I recall in the numbers in the report, 14 times with many failures earlier, through its lifetime, including the four recent tests since 2014, where the Russians really decided to get serious about it. Similarly, there were leaks about the system now called Poseidon that appear to have been intentional leaks in the Russian press several years ago, and that had already been, it seemed to be under development. So it is clear that these systems are not newly under development, but for whatever reasons, Putin decided to come public with all of them at one time.
Still for a, just for a follow-up, if I may. So I think the Russians have publicly said that that the impetus for many of these systems was to defeat missile defense after the United States withdrew from the ABM treaty. So to, I think, kind of get at the question that, by the way, I'll introduce her, Rita Gunther from the National Academy of Sciences, asked, is to what extent is, you know, does your research indicate that any of these were started after 2002, 2003?
Yeah, Lynn's comment is great, the ABM treaty going out of force, and I think really was, truly was, an event that triggered new thinking in Russia about delivery systems. Now, I just also want to say that, you know, it is not U.S. policy that we intend to use missile defenses against Russia's strategic range nuclear weapons. So it's stated policy that is not what we intend to do with our missile defense. But at the same time, they're concerned either about today's capabilities or, more importantly, about future capabilities, and don't want to fall behind.
And the policy is that the United States doesn't intend to undermine the Russian deterrent through missile defense. Another question here. Please identify yourself.
Richard Speer with the RAND Corporation. Do you have any information on whether Russia might want to export any of these systems?
Well, thank you, and I should just say that RAND did a very nice study on hypersonics, which I used extensively for this reporting. The only export sort of flag has to do with the aeroballistic Iskander missile that I came across. The rest would be entirely speculation, but there is an export version of the Iskander missile, not this one. I think that should be watched.
Can I embellish that and say that the Russians, to the extent they export any of their delivery vehicles, it's for intended for conventional delivery only, and they are, they have legally binding requirements not to transfer warheads, and in fact, they don't do that. Okay. So, yeah, nuclear. Michael
Lowenthal with the National Academy of Sciences. Jill, I'll add my congratulations here. What is your wish list for additional information? If you could fill in a gap or reduce an uncertainty, where would you want to do that most within the work that you've done here?
Yeah. Well, thanks, Micah. That's a great question. It would definitely be testing of the Poseidon. Testing of the other system. So I'm big on tests. You can say a lot of things, but if a test has occurred. It speaks volumes versus press releases. And so the test that is most difficult for us to see and is the test of the Poseidon. And of course, that's a strategic game-changing weapon. So I think it would be my answer.
Have any questions in the middle of the room, Nancy?
Hi, Nancy Gallagher, University of Maryland. So you just used the phrase strategic game changer, right? Which obviously sounds, really scary. And in a number of times when you were talking about these capabilities, you highlighted sort of the psychological effects of talking about developing different types of capabilities. I'm having real trouble, though, figuring out whether any of these systems, if they were actually developed to fruition, would give the Russians a militarily useful capability that they don't already have, or if this is really much more a psychological game about trying to both reassure their own public and dissuade the United States from going forward with a hypothetical comprehensive missile defense system.
That is a completely fair and accurate assessment that, you know, nuclear weapons today are pretty powerful and have strategic effects. The Poseidon, I say that, so it is true that there is an aura around these systems and intended aura, I believe. The Poseidon is, because it has a very large warhead, which in general we've been trying to get rid of in both the US and Russian systems, and because it could target sub bases, seems pretty scary to me. But so that's that. Now, could you destroy those today with today's weapons? Well, you can destroy darn near anything with today's weapons. So in that regard, your comment is just right. It's still scary to have completely new delivery systems for gigantic warheads.
And I'll give one more.
Can I ask a follow-up question?
Oh.
So what would you say, Jill, about the time for detecting the Poseidon?
Yeah, the Poseidon is...
Is that a qualitative difference to an air launch?
Well, it is, and it may actually... Well, so the Poseidon, this is the offense-defense issue that Senator Nunn referred to. Then, I mean, one of the interesting things about the Poseidon is it's likely going to... I mean, even though it's fast for a torpedo, it may likely take 40 hours to, if it's released from sort of safe waters in Russia, traveling towards a US coast, that distance and speed would take like 40 hours. And no matter how quiet it is, we're, you know, likely to see it. But then it gets into this game of, so do we develop defeat? And so then you're in an offense defense game and just ratcheting up the whole nuclear issues from what we have today to an additional level. So, or do you just, it may change us to change our submarine base protocols.
Okay, one more in the center and then I'll take a few from the left and we'll wrap up. So,
thank you. Adam Dietrich, Graduate School for Public International Affairs at the University of Pittsburgh. I wanted to take a quick moment to thank you guys for highlighting the importance of arms control and how New START would still apply to a lot of these systems. As a kind of final follow-up to this idea, do any of these systems really change the strategic landscape with existing first strike and second strike capabilities of the US and Russia?
No.
My own thought is that strategic landscape is being affected more by cyber and by possibility of artificial intelligence and weaponization of space, because all of that gets to the quality of information, the accuracy of information, the possibility of false warnings, and the time for decision makers to come to grips with whether to fire their own weapons if they think they're under attack.
As a quick follow-up to AI thing, then, is the idea of keeping humans in the loop more important, or is the U.S. policy of that going to slow us down in terms of dealing with false positives and false negatives?
Well, that's probably a subject for a lot of discussion, but there are a lot of articles being written now by serious people that are looking at this compressed decision time and saying that we're going to have to move toward more use of artificial intelligence. And some of them are going further, saying that things have become more and more automatic. So that gets into question whether you keep humans in a loop.
I think that I heard Ash Carter make a speech, former Secretary of Defense, in Aspen a year ago, and he talked about the importance of keeping humans in the loop, and I'm sure there are an awful lot of people that feel that way. But if we get so-called dead hands in Russia and dead hands in the United States and other countries, that's, to me, a very, very dangerous development. It's dangerous enough when you got humans.
But I would just add, I think the most likely thing is a hybrid system of AI and humans. So I think it'll be neither in isolation.
Okay, we have time for just two more, and then we'll carry our discussion out in the hallway. So next one goes to Michael Crapon.
Michael Crapon, Stimson Center. Jill, NTI, thank you for this work. Jill, do any of these systems that you're looking at, would they require renewed nuclear testing in your view? I ask this question because the numbers that we've got, there aren't many of them left, will be hard to hold on to, and even harder to extend to third parties. And in that case, maybe an interim approach is to push norms forward along with codes of conduct, backed up by whatever numbers we can keep. But certainly one crucial norm that is multilateralizable, even if the CTBD isn't in place officially, is the no testing business. So is that jeopardized by what you're looking at?
I don't think so. So again, let me just say that there's very little information about any nuclear warhead development that is involved in this report. So there is speculation in the press or information in the press about what sorts of warheads, that the yield of the warheads might be. And all of those yields are within things that have been done before. So they range from tens of kilotons to 2 megatons, and that range of warhead we know has been fielded before, so there's no reason to believe new testing would be needed.
Okay, last question from this side, the gentleman.
Hi, Jeff Smith from the Center for Public Integrity. Thank you very much for this very interesting account. The narrative that you provide, both you and Lynn, Jill, is quite different from the one we hear from the administration. The administration officials ranging from General Hyten to the current head of the Defense Intelligence Agency have stressed instead that the Russians are developing systems which would lie outside the START treaty within the range of its extension, and that these are potent threats, viable, will be completed, deployments will be completed in this time period, all contrary to the account you've given today. And I'm just wondering if you would comment on why you think that their narrative is so different from yours, and why it seems to be, according to your account, counterfactual.
Well, I wouldn't call the administration's account counterfactual. I would say it's consistent with a press reporting that comes from Russia. I would just say what's different about the work that I did is that I looked for evidence that the systems were being developed and were mature enough to be deployed at the times that the Russians are saying they'll be deployed, and found something different through evidence, by examining evidence of testing. So.
I'll just add, and then I guess I'll sort of have the last word. I would just say that this is clearly still an open question in the administration. And again, I think the fact that The Russians have now confirmed that they too agree that two of the systems that could be deployed, likely will be deployed before 2026, and that in fact, you know, would be covered by the treaty is really significant, and it's new information. Obviously, this discussion should be going on in official channels between our country and Russia about that and nailing that down. But that's a significant data point to address one of the key concerns that I understand is being discussed. There can also be a discussion about the other two systems that would be new kinds under the treaty, and so therefore how it would treat them, you know, is up for discussion. But there could be an agreement. You know, we should be seeking an agreement from the Russians that if they deploy these things within the lifetime of the treaty, they're willing to discuss them and consider how the treaty would apply. So it seems to me there's, and you have to look at what's the alternative. I mean, the alternative is losing everything we have now in terms of mutual restraint on numbers, on verification, on existing systems as well as new systems, and any of the things that we as a country want to do in addition, whether it's addressing non-strategic nuclear weapons, whether it's addressing the nuclear weapons of other countries, which, by the way, are orders of magnitude less in terms of numbers, although obviously still significant. None of those things, you know, none of those objectives is advanced by letting New START lapse. I mean, all of them are enhanced by having the foundation of New START in place and giving us time to then pursue these things, which take a lot of time, first of all, to develop really U.S. negotiating positions, including on if we want new things to be on the table, we're going to have to be prepared to put those analogous systems that we have on the table, too. And that discussion hasn't really happened yet. So it takes time to have a position. It takes time to negotiate. It takes time to get Senate advice and consent. None of that's going to happen in the next 12 to 14 months. So anyway, I you know, the hope is that new information, new considerations, the Russian clarifications, which were helpful recently, you know, can help advance a discussion in the U.S. government that this is in our interest.
I feel compelled to add. So it, you know, this is the information based on what's evident and available today, open source. So two caveats, there may be things that aren't open source that, you know, could change this. The second caveat is Russia could decide to increase the pace of development of any of these systems, and we could see a lot more testing, and it would change then the estimate of a deployment date. So, you know, I make the comment, I'm sure this is not all accurate, but it's as good as we can do right now, given open source analysis. But there are things that could change this. And so, you know, that's sort of always the case, and it is the case here.
Secretary Moniz or Senator Nunn, would you like the last word? Or
My last word would be to thank especially Jill, again, for all this effort.
My last word will be that, Jill, I think what you said was that you were comparing real work with pronouncements. I just say that's dangerous business in Washington.
And on that note, we thank everyone.